The subcommittee will come to order. Before we begin with statements from members and witnesses, I'd ask unanimous consent that Mr. Smith of Missouri and Mr. Crawford of Arkansas be allowed to sit with the subcommittee and participate in today's hearing. Hearing no objections, so ordered. We'll begin with 5-minute opening statements. Today, the Water and Power Subcommittee meets to take testimony on the administration's so-called National Blue Ways Order and to hear from communities that have been impacted by this order. The National Blue Ways Order appears to have originated through a leftist environmental organization called American Rivers, whose CEO at the time, Rebecca Water, is now senior advisor to the Department of Interior, spearheading this drive. Ms. Water was invited to appear before the subcommittee, but has declined to do so. In a nutshell, the National Blue Ways Order was never authorized by Congress, but simply imposed by administrative fiat in May of last year through Secretarial Order 3321. Although the department cites broad general authority under three federal acts, as we shall hear, these claims are dubious and yet to be tested in court. This sweeping order, whose stated intention is to impose federal designations on waterways that it describes as a headwaters-to-mouth approach to rivers management, end quote, is asserting authority that Congress has hitherto reserved to itself through the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act. The secretarial order allows, quote, any established stakeholder partnership, which would include distant environmental advocacy groups, to nominate a river and for the department then to impose the designation. As we shall hear, the implications of this designation can be economically devastating to local economies. For example, in January of this year, the department announced the designation of the White River watershed as a blue way, a 17.8 million acre drainage area spanning 60 counties and 722 miles of main stem river in southern Missouri and northern Arkansas. As we shall hear, it did so with no public testimony and despite widespread local opposition. Less than 2 weeks ago, the department was forced to abandon this plan in the face of rapidly mounting local and congressional opposition. Although the order speaks of coordination and consultation, we've learned that there is none. Indeed, in April, this subcommittee heard testimony from a Wyoming conservation director about the process he had witnessed in his own region. He asked, quote, how can a designation that requires no public notice, no comment opportunity, and was created without coordination or consultation with affected landowners, local governments, or states, result in increased coordination? The implications of this overreach are breathtaking. As a recent letter signed by 79 environmental advocacy groups says, with 3.5 million miles of rivers across the country, we have only scratched the surface when it comes to establishing blue ways. There's tremendous potential to expand existing trails and create new ones, end quote. Now, to those who suggest that these orders are a precursor to enhancement of recreational opportunities along these waterways, I invite them to look toward Yosemite National Park in my district, where the administration is seeking to expel long-standing recreational services from the Yosemite Valley, including bicycle and raft rentals, horseback riding, and many other commercial amenities. This subcommittee has repeatedly invited Ms. Water to testify about this sweeping headwaters-to-mouth National Blue Ways Order, and continues to seek answers to many questions, including the legal authority for this order, the process by which the designation is imposed, the regulatory implications of designation, and the due process afforded by all those who are directly impacted by it. To date, this subcommittee has been met by silence. Earlier today, in response to rapidly building public opposition, the new Secretary of Interior offhandedly announced she's calling a pause to the Blue Waters Order, quote, until we figure out the future of the program. Well, the subcommittee welcomes this announcement, but the question occurs, does this mean a pause until the heat dies down, or does it mean a genuine intention to step back from a legally suspect, economically damaging, and politically unpopular initiative? That's one of the questions I would have liked to have asked Ms. Water. The Congress and the American people are entitled to forthright answers from this administration, not stonewalling. Now, this is particularly urgent in light of the avowed intention by the program supporters to turn their sights on all 3.5 million miles of American streams and rivers. But we can at least shine a light on this practice by affording those citizens and taxpayers who've been directly affected by it to have a say in the decision-making process, and we do so today. I yield back the balance of my time and recognize the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And today's hearing focuses on the secretarial order that created the National Blue Waste Program. The intent of the program should be one that both Democrats and Republicans and others should support, a more coordinated effort by federal agencies to support the actions of localities in the watershed. Yet today we're here to criticize the program that is voluntary, it is discretionary, and essentially it is in designation only in name. I agree with the majority. There are questions about the program need to be addressed, and I'm especially interested in the role that public input and participation has played in the designations. I'm disappointed the department chose not to testify at today's hearing. However, I believe Secretary Jewell's comments today at an earlier morning committee hearing, her commitment to delve into the details of the program before additional designations are made, should help alleviate concerns from the other side of the aisle. Her decision to rescind the White River designation is also an indication that the department is taking a hard look at the program. There are very real concerns about the program, which we will hear from our witnesses today. And the committee is also taking issue on this issue on the road with a field hearing in Rep. Smith's of Missouri's district in 2 weeks. Yet there are also very real concerns across the country due to drought. As of last week, nearly half the country is experiencing moderate to exceptional drought. Drought record and record high temps have led to extremely dry conditions, creating fodder for the wilderness fires, scorching the wildfires, also scorching the Southwest and the West. As the authorizing committee, we have the ability to hear legislation like the Drought Relief Act. The Drought Relief Act is a widely supported program that would provide the Bureau of Reclamation with tools to help our communities in time of drought. Yet, despite being introduced since the beginning of Congress and the authorization having expired last year, it is yet to have a hearing. There are also several tribal water rights settlements like the Blackfeet settlement in Montana that are awaiting introduction and subsequent committee consideration. There's also legislation like the Desalination Act that has had a hearing and is awaiting a markup. Mr. Chairman, I hope we can work together to consider these issues and subsequent legislation in the near future. Thank our witnesses, and also like to introduce into the record the current drought map, which shows central U.S. experiencing high amounts of drought, and also for the record, letters of support from Connecticut River designation from David Bingham, private citizen, Frederick Gahan, private citizen, Daniel Malloy, governor of Connecticut. As the committee may know, citizens in New England have long fought for private property rights dating back to the original Tea Party of 1773. Submit for the record letters of support from local governments, including City of Augusta in Woodruff County, City of Clarendon in Monroe County. Testimony received today also stated there were no local governments in support of either the Connecticut or the White River designations. Yet, I'm introducing this into the record to show that this is the correct support from those from those areas.
Without objection.
And I yield back.
The chair recognizes Ms. Lummis of Wyoming. 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. Wyoming's conservation districts, county commissioners, state legislators, and other citizens are concerned about the National Blue Waste Program, and rightly so. 5 or 6 months ago, none of us really knew what a blue way was. But thanks to Wyoming's neighbors in Montana, we learned that Interior official Rebecca Water was actively pushing for a designation of the Yellowstone River watershed. That's 22 million acres in Wyoming being targeted for a mysterious new federal designation. Yet the Department of the Interior did not engage a single Wyoming official or water user, not a one. So we did our homework, and what we found is not encouraging. We've learned that a blue way designation could potentially undermine private property rights, state primacy over water law, and local conservation efforts. We've learned that a blue ways designation can occur with no formal public process or opportunity for public comment. All it takes is the swipe of a pen. Today, we have an opportunity to explore another dimension of this controversial order. Under what authority does the Department of the Interior believe it can designate and manage millions of acres of private, state, and federal land? This program having been concocted by the Department of the Interior, the Congress has an opportunity and responsibility to examine whether they have the legal authority to do so. Mr. Chairman, I'm pleased to welcome Karen Bud Fallon of Cheyenne, Wyoming, who will help us unravel that very question. Ms. Bud Fallon is a renowned private property and Western water rights lawyer. Her legal representation is a tremendous asset to Wyoming citizens whose livelihoods are affected by the decisions of federal agencies and the environmental litigation that all too often follows. In addition to her legal practice, she has generated an impressive amount of policy literature. I want to commend her for her recent work to expose the abuse of the legal system by radical environmental organizations, in many cases at taxpayer expense, under attorney fee shifting statutes. Coincidentally, she's identified a potential litigation problem with the National Blue Ways Program, something I hope we can explore today. I also look forward to her insight on the legal basis, or lack thereof, for the National Blue Ways Program. Mrs. Bud Fallon has appeared before Congress in this committee several times over the years. We are fortunate to have the benefit of her expertise. With that, thank you, Mrs. Bud Fallon, for coming to testify, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing and paying much deserved attention to this important issue. I yield back.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes Mr. Smith of Missouri for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having us, and thank you for hosting the committee. Before I make my remarks, I'd first like to thank the witnesses for taking their time and traveling to Washington today to testify, including my good friend, Mr. Eddie Justice. Eddie hails from Poplar Bluff, a city in my district that would have been included in the White River National Blue Way. In addition to being a friend, Eddie uses the river for boating and camping frequently and is an active member of the Poplar Bluff civic community. As some unique insight into how his community and surrounding communities in Missouri were not included in the designation process at all. The process for designating these national blue ways has not always been voluntary, open, or public. And I commend these witnesses for being willing to discuss the blue ways issues today in an open forum. In much the same way, I'm disturbed by the refusal of Ms. Rebecca Water to testify today. Though this program is trumpeted as voluntary, open, and public, Ms. Water does not appear to be interested in making voluntary, open, and public comments at all. First, let me provide a little background about the district that I represent. Missouri's 8th Congressional District contains 30 counties in southeast and southern Missouri. It starts 40 miles south of St. Louis, goes down the mighty Mississippi, including the Boot Hill region, to about 40 miles east of Springfield, Missouri, to the very northwest corner of Rolla. My district is agriculturally diverse, growing everything but citrus and sugar. Importantly, for the purpose of this hearing, 14 of the 30 counties in my district contain land that would have been within the White River National Blue Way designation. In addition, our district includes the Ozark National Scenic Riverways, a National Park Service entity that spans through 5 counties on the western side of my district, including my home county of Salem. The parts of our local economy that are not driven by agriculture rely heavily on tourism and natural resources. Folks come from all over the state and around the country to be guided on float trips on the rivers and streams contained in my district. We have a thriving timber industry that produces lumber, charcoal, and finished wood products, and some of the district's largest employers mine lead and smelt aluminum. What is the common thread that ties together the components of agriculture, tourism, and natural resources in my district? Property rights, and our ability to use the land and its bounty to make a living. All too often, the federal government tugs at this thread, threatening to unwind the fabric of our economy, whether it is new regulations restricting farm labor, new EPA carbon emission rules that would shutter our largest employers, or shutting down access and restricting the use of our rivers and streams, my district is under attack. My constituents and I are tired of unelected Washington, D.C. bureaucrats creating new programs out of thin air that have the ability to end our way of life and the way that we make a living. While the White River National Blue Ways has been withdrawn, it is only the latest symptom of a disease that has embedded itself into the very core of this administration. They think that they know better than locals, and they think they can act on their own without congressional approval or oversight. Where does it stop? I challenge the members of this committee today to make it our goal not only to stop the national blue waste system all over the country, but also to fight the disease that have spawned. Local groups and individuals are often the best situated to manage their lands and resources. We don't need bureaucrats, mandates sent from them on high that may have drastic repercussions for our local communities. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The chair next recognizes the gentleman from Arkansas, Mr. Crawford, for 5 minutes.
I thank the chairman and appreciate your latitude here today. Thank you for holding this hearing, and I'd like to welcome Judge Robert Griffin and thank him for coming here today to testify. Judge Griffin led the efforts to oppose the Blue Way designation in Arkansas's Independence County. I'm very happy that he's agreed to come here today to share with us his experience with how this designation was handed down from Washington with little input from or notice to the people it would affect most. Also would request unanimous consent to submit for the record the resolutions from several of the counties in my state, including one from Judge Griffin's Independence County, which requested the Department of Interior's rescission of this designation.
Without objection.
I think it's critically important that we hear and understand why so many rejected this designation, and hopefully it will serve as a lesson for Washington bureaucrats that national pronouncements of local programs shouldn't be made without the input of those that they will most affect, without a yield back.
The chair notes that the bells have rung for attendance on the House floor, but we should have at least another 10 minutes that we can comfortably continue to meet. So I'll go ahead and begin with the public testimony. Again, for all of our witnesses, as we outlined in the invitation letter, the rules allow 5 minutes per testimony. There'll be a green light until the final minute, when a yellow light will go on, red light at the end of 5 minutes. And with that, I'm very pleased to recognize the Honorable Robert Griffin, an Independence County judge from Batesville, Arkansas, to testify.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, Honorable Members, I welcome this opportunity to come before you to explain the grassroots effect of having an executive-driven initiative come downstream. And first, I want to explain what a county judge is, because that may be a foreign concept to this committee. I'm more the county administrator. I do have some limited judicial roles, but very limited. So I'm over the system of roads. I'm over the administration of the legislation of the quorum court, and I choose to honor the separation of government in our county. When I have the executive ability to do things, I do not do them. I would rather involve my quorum court and seek their input. So I'm very much against executive-driven directives. The White River bisects our county. The main concern I had, and again, since my written testimony is for the record already, is to discuss the way that it is seen in their initiatives. In the nominating document, it does not recognize the White River having any significance except limiting fish passage. That reservoir that is created by Lock 1 is a reservoir of water for 25,000 people. It is a reservoir for farmers to irrigate from. And it has much more significance. It feeds our industries that are located in Batesville, Arkansas, in the nearby proximity. So it has a much deeper impact than just the passage of fish. It's been there for 100-something years, impacting in that manner. Yet we have seen our county grow from the 50s to double in population into the 2000s. The partnerships that it implies, we fully support partnerships. We partner with Game and Fish Commission on half a dozen projects in our county. Those are voluntary participations. If there's a project that we can try to do, then we work together. Also, NRCS, a national agency under the Department of Agriculture, we partner with them in various projects. In fact, we have two or three that we're working toward right now. But again, those are voluntary participations. That's where we identify a problem. We seek their help, we go through the permitting process, and we do the things that are necessary to help impact the lives of our citizens in Independence County. 80% of our property is privately owned, and we can only imagine what initiatives may be brought down when the Secretarial Declaration 3321 implies broad United States code in being able to enact this partnership. Something else is much more troubling is the fact that they seek to solicit other partners and manage those partners. And that was done in a way that they got at least three solicitations for the nomination from local governmental or quasi-governmental agencies. The mayor of Clarendon has a project that's being worked with the Corps on the Cache River. He was encouraged to write a letter of support in exchange for the hope of more funding for that project. The mayor of Augusta, Arkansas, I spoke with him. Now, this is hearsay because I spoke to him and I'm relaying it to you. I talked to him. He has a U.S. Fish and Wildlife office that he trusts that agent very much, and he asked for his support, and he did. One of my local county judges is on a Cache River Coalition, a project that very desperately needs to be done. There's a log jam that's been there in existence probably 40 or 50 years that has now got work toward moving it in a partnership with, a voluntary partnership with the Corps and other partners. He was encouraged on the promise of funding, but the truth is the funding for all these projects is already there and was already there, but that's a perfect example of how they were solicited for their support and managed to believe what the, what it was saying. Water is very important, not just to California, ranking member. I mean, and I know you're, I think Los Angeles County, you live in about 100,000 population city. Water's very important. Your city is out of water today if you were over in Maryland. 100,000 people out of water of a 54-inch water main. 3 to 5 days are going to be out of water. If you don't think water's important to them and their access to that water, go talk to those people today. They're not going to have a shower or a water to drink in that length of time. So it has an impact even to the public utility and the aspect that the people need water. The main problem is, and I'm gonna quote what I said, is found in Cool Hand Luke. When the captain explained to Luke, what we have here is failure to communicate. This process was done, executive driven, it come downstream to us, and we had to live with the result. Thankfully, it has been withdrawn at this time. We would hope to see the entire thing rescinded, and I think the suspension wording is somewhat troubling. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you for your testimony. Our next witness is from Poplar Bluff, Missouri, Mr. Eddie Justice, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to come and testify in front of this committee. I also want to thank our Congressman, Mr. Smith, for the work that he's done in fighting this, because it is the will of the people in our district that this not take place. I was watching earlier the Committee on Natural Resource, where Secretary of Interior Sally Jewell was commenting, and the congressman from Utah asked her what her plans were in regard to working with local communities and working with people on the ground as these orders went forward. And she said that she gave her commitment to work with the people on the ground as she went forward, as well as to follow the law. I hope that this is true. I hope that she will keep her word, because if she does coordinate with people on the ground, she will not be following the example of her predecessor. The Mr. Salazar, who signed this order, never once that I have any knowledge of came to the White River watershed, never once held a town hall meeting there, never once had interaction with county commissioners. I know of at least 16 counties in this watershed that have signatures from county commissioners saying that they did not have a single clue this was going to happen, and they would not have supported it if it had, and they have sent letters saying so. There was a news release by the Department of Interior on January the 1st, 2013 that said that this initiative is part of President Obama's America's Great Outdoors Initiative and is established as a community-driven conservation recreation agenda of the 21st century. There have been rumors that this is a collaborative effort. There have been rumors that this is a cooperative effort. Haven't seen it. Wouldn't that require maybe some announcement in a newspaper, or with TV or radio or town halls, or some way getting the input and cooperation of local people? We have not seen it in these counties. The residents of this watershed deserve better. Our economy has in large part been based on recreation and tourism, and in cattle farming, and in row crop farming. None of this is possible without these waterways. And yet we have, in the past, had the Ozark National Scenic Riverway come in part of the Current River, which is a direct or is a contributor in the watershed to the White River. When, at least with the Ozark National Scenic Riverway, Congress acted and they put this in place. But if you look at what that order looked like and what has happened since with the regulations, with what the Department of Interior has done, they are unrecognizable. And that is what the people in our area are concerned about. They are concerned about this being the first step of the Department of Interior coming in and controlling our access to our river, our size of horsepower, the access we have for our cattle, the access we have for our entertainment and recreation through boating. The general management plan of the Department of Interior over the Ozark National Scenic Riverway has increased regulation on us and is about to do it again. They have a plan that's about to come out that is going to restrict us to a point that it could cripple our economy up and down the Current River to in a way that would probably be unrecoverable. That's the kind of regulation that we are seeking to avoid. That's the kind of regulation that we cannot afford. We, as the people in this area, have invested our lives, invested our children's future, invested everything we have in what is in this area. And it is very frustrating for us to have a controlling nanny type agency trying that of people who probably have never even visited our area trying to come down and tell us and regulate us to a point that we, our businesses will no longer be viable, our future for our children to recreate there and have homes there and have businesses there could no longer be a possibility. Not only should this declaration be rescinded and or put on pause, it needs to be taken away and it should never be come back again. There are rumors that and accusations that the Department of Interior is looking at doing 25 more of these over the next 5 years. If the people in these other 25 areas are treated like we've been treated through this designation with no say whatsoever, as if they know what's best for us, then I feel sorry for them and I think they should stand up and fight just the way we are. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Justice. To our witnesses and to the audience, I apologize. We are required to break here in order to attend to business on the House floor. That business is likely to take, I would think, at least 45 minutes. So we'll reconvene sometime, hopefully not long after 2:15. I thank you for your indulgence. It's an occupational hazard with afternoon hearings around here, but the committee will stand in recess until the call of the chair at some point after 2:15.
All right, see you okay. Not soon.
3 single time, so I have to really fall farther from the tree, you know.
The committee will reconvene. The chair thought it had promised later than 3:15, or not earlier than 3:15, but staff informs me I actually said 2:15, so I guess we're covered on all of that. And again, I apologize to the witnesses as well as to the audience members for the interruption. Good Lord willing, and the crick don't rise, I don't think there'll be any further interruptions. We had left off with Mr. Sutton Bacon to begin his testimony, and again, thank you for your patience. Welcome to Washington, and go for it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. My name is Sutton Bacon. I'm the CEO of the Nantahala Outdoor Center, and I'm here to offer insights about how programs like the National Blue Ways system can properly function, primarily through a small business lens. As a background, NOC is the largest outfitter guide company in the United States. We operate in 12 national forests and parks, and we help over 1 million Americans experience public lands and waterways each year. To put that in perspective, our guests paddle enough river miles each year to travel to the moon and back twice. I'm also a small business owner. I employ 250 full-time employees and have over 1,000 seasonal employees on my payroll right now. We're the largest employer in our region, and I know firsthand about the economic and regulatory challenges that small business owners face. We're located high in the mountains of Western North Carolina, and like so many other small rural communities, our economy has suffered immensely through the recession. Plus, 88% of our county is federally owned. And one might say that our current economic situation is exacerbated because of these large federal land holdings that diminish our tax base. However, nothing could be further from the truth. We are located in one of the most conservative congressional districts in the state of North Carolina, and we proudly cling to a set of strong mountain values, such as hard work, honest communication, and family values. And central to our values is stewardship of our lands and waters. Our community fully understands that outdoor recreation is the pathway to a growing and sustainable prosperity, one that is rooted in an experience-based economy, not an extraction-based economy. It can't be outsourced overseas as long as the health and protection and integrity of our natural resources are maintained. These jobs and economic impact will never go away. For example, on the Nantahala River, it alone is an $85 million per year industry sustaining over 1,000 full-time jobs. In fact, it directly supports over 20% of the workforce in our community. We are the story about rural economic development. And to further enhance these economic dividends, we have created a regional watershed partnership, including the Outfitter Guide Community, the Forest Service, Duke Energy, the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Nation, local government, private landowners, businesses of all stripes, local universities and community colleges, nonprofits, and user groups. We are investing mostly private dollars in fundamental recreation infrastructure, implementing a cooperative marketing plan around our rivers and lakes, hosting national and international events in paddle sports and fishing, and we are establishing a 10-year community vision for our waterways. Drawing from our mountain values, we've shown that diverse and even competing interests can be overcome by earnest dialogue and cooperation. And all of this is happening solely because of our own initiative and a bottom-up effort to improve our community. As such, we are precisely the kind of community and diverse willing stakeholder group that could benefit from future federal recognition programs such as the National Blue Ways. We would absolutely, in our region, cherish the recognition, the blue ribbon, and especially the brown DOT highway sign that we could put on our interstate. I believe there are opportunities for the federal government to create tools that can engage local stakeholders and support a locally determined vision, since we all agree that community-based leadership promotes better management of our natural resources than distant and sometimes problematic bureaucratic intervention. As such, these voluntary partnerships can be heralded through programs and branding programs like the Blue Ways that support local communities just like ours who are dedicated to using their waterways to improve quality of life, create jobs, improve property values, and foster healthy, more active families. I would suggest to the committee that efforts like the National Blue Ways system don't just promote natural resource ecosystems, but also the ecosystems of rural economic development. Most of the $85 million we generate on the Nantahala flows right back into the small towns where we live and work, supporting far more than the 1,000 people we employ directly. I appreciate the opportunity to share my testimony with you today. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. And our final witness is Ms. Karen Bud Fallon, attorney for Bud Fallon Law Offices in Cheyenne, Wyoming, to testify.
Thank you very much. Is that better? All right, thank you. I'm also an attorney specializing in protecting private property rights, rural communities, rural counties, and multiple use on the federal lands. Today, I would like to offer to this subcommittee legal and factual information surrounding Secretarial Order 3321, the National Blueways Initiative. In my opinion, this initiative has no basis in federal statute and should be withdrawn. The U.S. Constitution that set forth the very foundation of this nation requires that the bureaucracy can only act under the direction of Congress. There is simply no congressional authority for the National Blue Ways Program. Additionally, like its predecessor, the Great American Outdoors Initiative, the National Blue Ways Order was never published or made available for public comment in the Federal Register, nor has there been any compliance with NEPA or other rulemaking processes. There simply has been no public input. Now, make no mistake about it, these kind of special land designations have very real personal, social, and economic impacts on landowners, rural communities, small businesses, and local governments. This is true whether it's a congressionally designated area, such as wilderness or wild and scenic rivers, or a bureaucratically designated area such as a national monument, a blue way, lands with wilderness characteristics, a water trail, or the brand new MOU that just came out that creates landscape and watershed scale conservation demonstration areas. None of those have got congressional authority. In fact, the MOU that I talks about cites as its only congressional authority as America's Great Outdoors Initiative. Although such designations are often accompanied by great proclamations that they are going to focus and coordinate federal resources, or that existing land uses will be protected, this is simply not proven to be the case. Existing uses are almost always negatively impacted, either with regulatory impositions or because of radical environmental group litigation. While special designations will impact local citizens and the local economy, these same communities and citizens rarely have a voice in the management of specially designated lands and waters. Indeed, the Interagency National Blueways Committee, established under Order 3321, includes no representatives of state governments, local governments, or private citizens. Furthermore, for these, quote, multi-state watersheds, only one state sponsor is required. I would argue that any proposed designation should receive a state sponsor from each and every state affected, as well as the support of a majority of impacted local governments. The congressional delegations in impacted states should also have input and fair ability to comment on proposed designations, but that is not what the executive order allows. Additionally, concerning is the fact that under Order 3321, Department of Interior is not required to view state and local land use management plans. Natural resource conservation districts and counties across the nation have land management plans to protect its waters and its watersheds. Yet the federal government does not review a single one of these plans before imposing an entirely new designation on top of them. The DOI proposes to, quote, realign DOI agency and bureau activities and programs to protect and restore and enhance natural, cultural, and recreational resources of a designated river. To reassign agency purposes at the whim of the bureaucracy is to take huge liberty with congressionally designated purposes, flying in the face of federalism. This order may also invite increased involvement into areas not traditionally within the purview and jurisdiction of the federal government, such as state and private lands. The National Blue Ways is not precedent setting for its overreach or lack of statutory basis. In order to protect ourselves from this unconstitutional abuse of power, we must continue to demand our nation's founding principles of checks and balances be honored. I would be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much for your testimony and all of you for your attendance today. We'll now go to five-minute questions from the members, and the chair will begin with Judge Griffin. We were told earlier that the Blue Ways are voluntary. It's an open process. It's a designation in name only. Why is that objectionable?
As long as it's truly voluntary, we participate in programs every day that are voluntary.
Did you find it to be voluntary?
I apologize.
Did your community find the designation of the White River to be voluntary?
There was no one notified it was even happening, so it certainly was not voluntary. It was compulsory.
Mr. Justice, was that your impression as well?
There were 16 counties that I have talked to, or people in my around me have talked to, that their county commissioners signed letters that they did not, they knew nothing about this. So if the very people who were responsible for the operation of these counties knew nothing about it and signed letters to say such.
So it's voluntary then in the sense that it is imposed upon you without consultation.
That's the, to the best of my knowledge, that's the way to
say it. A new definition of the word as far as I can tell.
I've only thing I've ever volunteered for is when somebody asked me if I wanted to do it and I said yes.
We just heard testimony that this designation would enhance recreational opportunities by giving the river a little special recognition, that's all. What's not to like about that?
Well, there was a letter posted on the Department of Interior's website by a lady named Debbie Doss from the conservation chair of Arkansas Conservation Coalition. She said this was like winning a beauty contest. Well, in a beauty contest, don't you first decide to enter, second, prepare for it, and third, want to be judged?
But if it's simply a matter of putting pretty signs up saying that this is a national Blue Ways River, what's wrong with that?
Let me point out the wording, Mr. Chairman, of limiting human encroachment into the floodplain. That does not seem to be very recreational-minded.
Limiting human encroachment into the flood, well, that would include things like, what, river rafting and fishing and probably all the stuff that Mr. Bacon's folks do. What exactly do you do over there in your neck of the woods?
Fly fishing, rafting, kayaking.
Well,
yes, sir.
Don't you realize you're encroaching on the floodplain and the river?
Yes.
And it doesn't bother you that the federal government is producing a designation that could well end up banning your activities?
I think one key difference in our circumstance, Mr. Chairman, than the other members of the panel is that we operate almost predominantly on federal land. We do not have the same kind of private land issues.
But let me warn you about the commercial operators that are doing business in the Yosemite Valley and have for nearly 100 years. River rafting rentals, bicycle rentals, horseback riding rentals. National Park Service is now seeking to remove all of those enterprises from the Yosemite Valley floor. And by the way, the reason that is often stated in meetings is because these are commercial enterprises, and commercial enterprises are incompatible with the public lands. In fact, they go to great lengths to assure us that bicycle riding and horseback riding will still be allowed. It just cannot be commercially provided on the valley floor. Wouldn't a similar policy affect your operation?
It would.
Well, what do you think of that sentiment that commercial enterprises are incompatible with our public lands?
I will not contest that there are case-by-case challenges throughout the country, around the United States, where public recreation and commercial outfitting is challenged by our land management agencies.
Well, I think that you will find you are taking a giant step in that direction, and running athwart of a warning often given by Ronald Reagan, which was, if you get in bed with the federal government, you better expect something more than a good night's sleep.
Point taken.
Judge Griffin, your testimony talked about how the White River Blue Ways Commission documents targeted three hydroelectric dams owned by the city of Batesville, Arkansas, because they reduced fish passage. Could you tell me very briefly about those dams and what the outcome could have been under the White River Blue Way?
Each of those create a pool of water probably 6 to 8 feet deep. They increase the fishing area and enhance that. But also the critical thing is actually irrigation water and water for the substance of people, 25,000 people that's in that area that depend on that pool of water for drinking water.
Thank you. Ranking Member Napolitano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Bacon, your experience as an outfitter and a taxpayer, do you think that makes sense for the variety of federal agencies who are engaged in the management of our nation's water resources to better coordinate their efforts to support local initiatives and to maximize efficiency?
I would say, of course. I think the coordination is, I think, our single biggest opportunity when dealing with multiple federal agencies. I would say, most importantly, there needs to be a cultural change within our agencies to become, specifically, we deal with the Forest Service almost predominantly, to really put the Forest Service in the recreation business and acknowledge that recreation is a fundamental component to its mission delivery. And I think, so coordination, yes, I agree with that statement too. We've got to make sure that our agencies are in the recreation business and that we do everything on a line coordinated approach. Ultimately, private business, private enterprise, using our public lands is what is creating the jobs, the economic impact that we've talked about. So our land agencies need to facilitate that.
Thank you. Well, you know, nominations for the Blue Ways are submitted by localities to the Department of Interior. Is that correct?
That is my understanding.
So maybe DOI didn't totally reach out to every single aspect of those that should have been involved, and shame on them if they didn't.
It seems to me, without knowing a lot of the details, that there are process issues that the Department of Interior needs to address.
Well, hopefully this new secretary will take care of that. In your testimony, sir, you state 88% of the Swain County is federally owned and managed. That's really on par with most of our counties in the West, but in your experience, it is a given that in a county with substantial federal land ownership, the economy does not have to suffer. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am, that is correct. We have numerous examples in the southeastern United States where we operate, where we almost have exclusively all federal lands and create millions of dollars of economic impact. Gatlinburg, Tennessee, for example, is a 10-square-mile island in the middle of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park, and it generates $500 million of direct consumer spending, leveraging the national park.
So then it behooves both areas, not only the federal government, but also entities that know that this might happen, to not interfere, but rather inject into the conversation things that they feel are important.
Absolutely.
Are there ways working collaboratively with stakeholders, the local, the state, the federal, and don't forget the partners, as you say, in business, people like you, that a community can thrive even when the federal taxpayers own substantial amounts of land in those areas?
I think the key is alignment within stakeholders. Whereas many different business interests, local interests, government interests, landowner interests can sometimes be in conflict, here in Western North Carolina, we find common ground on rallying around the travel and tourism industry, specifically the outdoor recreation component of the travel and tourism industry, that the rising tide truly does lift all boats.
And of course, they also value the protection of those rivers to ensure their health, and also of the watersheds, because it's important to them and to the ag areas.
Absolutely. If it weren't for the protection of our watersheds, the enhancement of recreation areas, and the protection of our natural resources, our guests would not recreate and come to the mountains to enjoy these wonderful all of the businesses that offer services there. Yes, ma'am.
Which is a job creator. Mr. Justice, can you give me an exact instance of a new regulation that would have been created due to the Blue Way designation?
No, ma'am, I can't, because that has not been defined yet, but the parallel that I made between that and the Ozark National Scenic Riverway, I think, is a good indication of what could possibly happen.
Could possibly happen.
Yes, ma'am, due to precedent. There have been some ideas that the Blue Way, some of the regulations of Blue Way, is to keep our cattle 180 feet away from the river. That completely destroys our cattle industry. If you look at the Ozark National Scenic Riverways, to where that they have put some of the Conservation Department have put boulders in front of some of the boating access points. They have made regulations to where you can't ride horses in the water. Completely opposite of the way that our rivers should be managed.
Well, there's some concerns about contamination of river waters, including some of the I would say manure and other river runoff from agriculture. So we need to ensure that we protect those rivers for the health of not only the business entities, but also the communities that use it for drinking water. Mr. Chair, I reserve any balance of my time later. Thank you.
We'll credit you with 3 seconds. Ms. Lummis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mrs. Bud Fallon, thank you and welcome. Thank you for coming. The order that designated this Blue Way designation says that nomination of a river may be done by any established stakeholder partnership, but it does not define this term. Do you think that that might allow a far-removed non-governmental special interest to nominate a river regardless of local concern or opposition?
Oh, I absolutely think that. Because the order doesn't require any kind of public input, it does not require the agreement of the states. Specifically, it does not include any requirement of local government knowledge. A stakeholder could be somebody from New York City nominating the Yellowstone River in Wyoming. And that would clearly not be right for the people in Wyoming.
Now, in your testimony, you mentioned that local governments already have comprehensive land and water conservation plans. So my question is, what would happen to this local planning under the Blue Ways implementation if the federal goal conflicts with local conservation plans?
The way the Blue Ways order written is right now is that the local plan would be subservient and would probably vanish. In Wyoming, conservation districts write these local land use plans based on state statute with absolute input of all of the people in that local area. And it's these people that are going to really understand that watershed, because clearly a watershed in northeast Wyoming is not the same as a watershed in southwest Wyoming. And so what you're going to have with these kind of federal designations is all of these locally carefully crafted on the ground plans are going to be diminished because you have a federal government top down, one size fits all from Washington that has not worked well for the West in the past, and I can't believe it will in the future.
Ms. Bud Fallon, also in your testimony, you suggest that the non-regulatory Blue Way designation can be the basis for lawsuits. Can you explain that further?
Yes, I can. As this congressional body knows, I have been heavily involved in looking at lawsuits from radical environmental groups. Most of these lawsuits involve challenges to federal land use plans. They don't challenge the land use plan or the federal designation on the merits. They challenge through some procedural process. And we've even had testimony and information by these radical groups saying that they are only doing this to wear down federal land managers, so they simply do what these groups want. These kind of designations harm hundreds of people who are trying to make a living on the land. We have to intervene in this litigation. We have done studies based on grazing litigation where the permittees have to intervene in these groups with the federal agencies. It can cost anywhere between $35,000 and $100,000 for a grazing permittee to try to intervene in litigation by an environmental group. And as you know, these environmental groups get their funding paid back in terms of attorney's fees from the federal government. And I can guarantee you that that will happen with this designation as it has with every single other either congressional designation or national monument designation or other agency designation.
So even though the Blue Ways secretarial order is just that, a secretarial order, is there still a threat of lawsuit and litigation? And does it constitute a regulatory burden?
It absolutely is a threat of litigation, because if you have a group that does not believe that the Blue Way is being managed in terms of how the Department of Interior designated it, because they believe that Interior ought to consider more environmental protection or different kinds of recreation, there will be federal court litigation. There's simply no reason to not litigate by these groups. And that will absolutely harm the individuals, including the recreationists, who are relying on that permit or that lease or that ability to use that land. It is absolutely a regulatory burden to have to defend the federal government just to get your lease or permit from the federal government.
Thank you. Quick question for Judge Griffin. The stakeholder partnership that nominated the White River, was it being driven more by federal officials or local officials?
It was driven entirely by federal officials in concert with programs that were going on with the local people. Mr. Chairman, could I indulge me one moment to address the ranking member's question?
Unfortunately, the gentlelady's time has expired, but we may get to that in a future question. Mr. Huffman for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We have heard a lot today about how this program might lead to certain things, might be interpreted certain ways, could have certain effects that could lead to other effects. And I'd like to try to dial this back in to what has actually occurred thus far in the real world. We've heard a question about potentially far removed NGOs and special interests could sort of parachute in and propose designation of Blue Ways. Can any of the witnesses tell me about a situation where that has actually happened, where far removed special interests have come into a watershed and actually proposed a designation that was accepted by the Department of Interior? Can anyone identify an example of that? How about the suggestion that this Blue Ways designation could somehow preempt local plans and authorities? Could anyone tell me an example of where this Blue Way designation has been proposed and that has had some sort of preemptive effect that invalidated or trumped local plans and local authorities? How about any regulatory effect at all? Can anyone identify any regulatory power that the Blue Way designation actually creates for any federal agency? Anything?
I would actually like to address that one. And I believe you're an attorney by trade, Mr. Huffman.
Yeah, I'm guilty of that.
Thank you. The thing that I see is when the Secretary of Interior in Section 3.
Sir, I want to just ask, if I, with all due respect, a specific answer to my question, which is, can you identify any specific regulatory power that Blue Ways designation creates for an
Section
agency?
3. It implies there are broad powers existing to create the
goals. Does it create any new authority?
Not that I'm aware.
Thank you. What about property rights? There's been a suggestion that this could devalue or encroach upon or violate property rights. Is anyone familiar with a situation where a Blue Ways designation has harmed anyone's property rights? How about water rights? Anyone lost any water as a result of the Blue Ways designation? Anyone been denied the ability to build something because it was alleged to encroach on the floodplain, anything like that? What about recreation? Has anyone been prevented from recreating because of a Blue Ways designation or proposed Blue Ways designation? I'm not hearing that. There was a suggestion that cattle might be kept 180 feet back if there was a Blue Ways designation. Has anyone ever been told they have to manage their cattle differently because a Blue Ways designation was proposed? Any specifics? Any other type of access to a river or watershed that's been affected in any way by the consideration or the actual designation of a Blue Ways? Well, it's kind of interesting that we've had what is an entirely hypothetical discussion here today about a program that frankly has been paused, even though it has not had any of the effects that folks have raised as concerns, but has nevertheless been paused so that there can be even extra consideration given to make sure that it is compatible with all the different stakeholders in these watersheds. But I think there's some perspective and context that we really need to bring to this discussion that has been missing from a lot of the testimony that we've heard. I just have one more question in the time that's been allowed from the gentlelady from Wyoming. You mentioned several times radical environmental groups. Can you identify an environmental group for me that's not radical? Or does that just automatically get joined into the name there? If you're an environmental group, are you radical? Or is there someone out there in the environmental community that maybe is not radical?
Actually, I can. If you look at local conservation groups, at groups that are environmental groups that are local in a small area and dealing with issues on the ground in that particular area, I do not believe that those groups are radical. The groups that I'm talking about are groups that are national groups, that when you look at their website, that they have an agenda to drive livestock grazing, timbering, mining, and recreation off the federal lands. And I can actually give you a list of those if you would like them.
I would love to hear the ones that you would have at least more trust and confidence in that you would regard as non-radical. But in any event, I just have a few seconds left. Let me reiterate that in California, we've been working for decades to get people out of their bunkers, working together to avoid heavy-handed regulation through these collaborative efforts. I think it's a good thing, and I'd like to see that program brought to our state. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Tipton, Colorado.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to be able to enter into the record a letter from the National Cattlemen's Beef Association opposing Blue Ways designation.
Without objection.
For many of the reasons that have been cited, for concerns that my good friend and colleague out of California cited, they are concerned about the heavy hand of the federal government coming in, not through this Congress, not through talking to you or talking to me or any other member at this committee, but by executive fiat making these designations. And maybe we can help find a few answers to a couple of the questions that you did pose. When we look at the White River designation, it is in the incorporating document for the proposed designation under the Blue Ways system to be able to have a 180-foot buffer zone on private property. Judge, would you call that a taking?
That would be a taking, yes.
Ms. Bud Fallon, would you call that a taking?
Yes, sir, I would.
Mr. Justice, is that a taking?
Beyond a shadow of a doubt.
Mr. Bacon, would you consider that a taking?
I'm not familiar with it.
Okay. So the federal government, by executive fiat, would set themselves up in a position to be able to come in and designate 180 foot on either side of a river to be able to tell you what to do with the property. That is a genuine threat. That is an actual taking and an impact that's going to have a real impact on a lot of our farmers and ranchers. Fortunately, the White River was withdrawn from consideration as a Blue Ways because the public, the people who actually live there, stood up and said, we don't want this. You've already testified that no locals were actually incorporated into the discussion, but we're talking about some of the outside groups that were maybe coming in and helping to push for a designation. Let's look at the White River, the National Wildlife Refuge Association, Nature Conservancy District, Ducks Unlimited, some good groups, not arguing that these are bad groups, but not all of them are invested in those areas. In the West, Ms. Bud Fallon, in the West, is water a private property right?
Yes, sir, it is.
Do you have state laws in Wyoming?
Yes.
Do you have priority-based systems in Wyoming?
Yes, we do.
Do you think it's appropriate for the federal government to be able to come in and start upsetting not only state law priority systems, but effectively taking private property rights through designation?
No, I do not.
Do you see any solutions? Do you have any comments on that, Judge?
I'm sorry, Representative Tipton.
Do you have some comments? Do you think it is the appropriate place for the federal government to be coming in and upsetting federal law, state law, priority-based systems, and private property rights in regards to water?
Absolutely not. Not when 80% of the people that own land do not wish to participate.
Do you see a problem, and is this an arrogance typically out of this administration, assuming that everything is community property and that they have a right on high in Washington, D.C., to come down into Arkansas, into Wyoming, to be able to go out through our states and to be able to make designations without passing a bill through Congress?
I think that any designation should have its origin only in Congress and thereupon having vetting in the proper legislative process.
Okay. Maybe we can run through a couple of questions here real quick, if you wouldn't mind. Well, we're a little short on time. Under the secretarial order creating the Blue Ways program, can any entity nominate? You guys have lived it.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes. Any entity can nominate a National Blue Way.
Mr. Bacon?
I believe so.
Mr. Justice?
That's what I believe it says.
Judge?
I believe so.
Okay. Can that entity be a non-governmental entity outside the basin, not accountable to the state or local governments? We just talked about that. Is that accurate?
That is accurate.
No arguments back on that. Can a National Blue Way Committee composed entirely of federal bureaucrats designate a Blue Way once it's been nominated through what appears to be a flawed process?
Yes, there are no state or local participants at all on that National Committee.
Any other comments on that? Great. So federal bureaucrats will be the ultimate decision makers on tri-state areas like the 44 million acre Yellowstone River watershed, even though landowners, local and state governments that manage the land as well, are going to be excluded.
That is correct.
So the federal government will come in and do this. Well, interestingly enough, we just had a meeting earlier today with Secretary Jewell of the Department of Interior. She noted that they were having a pause on the Blue Ways program, because it is obviously fundamentally flawed. They're going to be looking back to be able to examine this. I'd certainly like to encourage this Congress to stand up for state rights, for the priority-based systems, and the water law and private property rights of the American citizen, and not let this happen by executive fiat. With that, I yield back.
Chair recognizes Mr. Gosar of Arizona.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks for this hearing. What I'm very disappointed in is the administration couldn't be bothered to provide a witness today. I think we've given plenty of testimony from both sides that we needed to have somebody from the Interior to actually talk about the implementation of the National Blue Ways program. In my district, Rebecca Water has been traveling the country, basically selling folks in our district a false bill of goods and promising federal dollars in exchange for the Blue Ways designation. That is exactly what occurred in my state. Some well-intentioned local official in my district looking for any way to get resources to preserve the ecologically important Verde River have expressed interest in the program after hearing Water's promises. I am committed to working with those folks on issues pertaining to the Verde River, but I am specifically concerned about the Blue Ways designation that would bring and the potential burdens and it would impose on the resource management in exchange for this funding priority at the Interior. Ultimately, the department must come to Congress to authorize, as many of these guests have said, and these types of overarching land and water management decisions are very, very important. Ms. Bud Fallon, I mean, trust is a series of promises kept, right? Is that a good definition?
Not when you're dealing with the federal government, sir.
I'm loving that conversation now. So tell me what the federal government has actually done to uphold our trust in the western states. I grew up in Pinedale, by the way.
Oh.
I'm one of those Gosars.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
The federal government, for example, promised that livestock grazing would not be affected on the Grand Staircase Escalante National Monument. There are now very few livestock grazing permits on the Grand Staircase Escalante, even though the proclamation specifically protected livestock grazing. But because the bureaucracy of simply trying to renew permits and bring permits together and through a series of litigation by environmental groups, those permits have been eliminated, costing those local governments hundreds of thousands of dollars that recreation, even in that beautiful area, is never going to replace.
We haven't even started talking about the Endangered Species Act, have we?
No, sir, we have not.
That would have been a great one, folks, to pick up over there, because that's implied everywhere. I mean, that's been an implication on the federal lands, period, all the way across the board, and it's had a disastrous effect on economies, private land ownership, and everything else. How do you see this, you know, in this specific adjunct and the way you put things together, Ms. Budd-Fallon, when we see waters of the U.S. and the designation of the blue waters, particularly how do you see those conceived basically overarching and taking jurisdiction from private and state local jurisdictions?
The problem is that it happens very subtly. This is not something that they designate and all of a sudden uses are stopped. It's something that happens over a period of years as bureaucrats gain more power over the people, particularly in the West. I mean, I think we understand it better because we live with federal bureaucracies granting everything that we do, whether it's a term grazing permit or an oil and gas lease or whatever is keeping these rural communities alive. And so we understand what it's like to have the bureaucracy time after time be on top of you. In the West now, we're dealing not only with this, but with sage-grouse issues and what happens if the sage-grouse gets listed. I did listen to Secretary Jewell's testimony this morning, and she talked about how she appreciated the partnerships with the states on sage-grouse. What she forgot to mention is the sage-grouse is also in litigation in front of Judge Windmill in Idaho by Western Watersheds. And so all of these partnerships, and no matter how good the Department of Interior thinks the state programs are going, it's not going to be Interior that decides it. It's a federal district judge, in this case in Idaho, because that's where the case is. So it's not so much whether Congress thinks this is a good idea or a bad idea. When the agencies make these designations, what happens is that they take on a life of their own. They totally overtake the rural communities, and then they get litigated in federal court by somebody we can't fire and by somebody who gets to dictate how we live.
So do you have the ability to have a personal one-on-one discussion with the Secretary of Interior? Would you ever be getting that opportunity?
I would love that opportunity.
It'd be nice. You won't get it. Environmental groups get it. But I also want to finish up. You know, I have worked with the Nature Conservancy in the state of Arizona. They've actually come to the table with solutions. No isn't an answer anymore. But the Center for Biological Diversity believes that they ought to have poets and philosophers instead of science people. And that's some of the things that we want to talk about. And I'm happy to verse anybody on the opposite side about when we talk about aggressive NGOs. Thank you.
The gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Smith.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me ask Mr. Justice. You testified earlier in regards to the Blue Ways designation on the White River area. Were there any public meetings in Missouri that you're aware of?
I'm not aware of a single meeting held anywhere in the state of Missouri affected by the Blue Way.
So would it be your belief that it wasn't a voluntary program for the 14 counties in Missouri?
It absolutely was not.
What's your definition of local stakeholders?
Local stakeholders are local governments and local grassroots organizations and landowners that actually have invested their livelihood in making these areas succeed on an economic and a personal level.
Believe it or not, that's what the Secretary of Interior says. That is why the White River, a Blue Way, was created. It's because of local stakeholders. Yet there was no open public meetings in the 14 counties in Missouri. And there were not any local county commissions of those 14 counties that were in support. In fact, they're all opposed to it.
Right.
Does that sound like local stakeholders to you?
Absolutely not.
I think the concern that the individuals, and let me know with several of the witnesses there, you're worried about federal government implementing any kind of program with open guidelines. Wouldn't that be safe to say?
Federal government without restriction is dangerous.
Absolutely. We have limited powers. Is that correct?
That's absolutely right.
And they're defined by the Constitution. I don't see anywhere in the Constitution where it says that we should create a Blue Way in the White River Basin. Do you, Mr. Justice?
I sure haven't found it, and I've actually read it.
I don't. And, you know, inquiring the Secretary of Interior just a couple hours ago. I asked her about this program. And they've paused it, like we've mentioned, because they need to get to know more about the program. I've been on the job 42 days. I'm learning this program pretty good. She's been on the job for 3 months. She's been there a little bit longer. So I think that she should know the program a whole lot better. But what scares me is that the lead person that she said is Miss Rebecca Water. And she's almost like Lois Lerner, refusing to come testify. I would really love for the Obama administration to be more open and more transparent. And this is why the people in my district are scared to death when the federal government's trying to come in and implement a new designation with open guidelines and not knowing how it's going to affect our property rights and our constitutional rights. So I want to thank you all for being here again today.
We've had a request for an additional round of questions, so let me begin by addressing the line of questioning that my colleague from California, Mr. Huffman, raised, and that is, there doesn't seem to be any harm or any foul here. Now, first of all, why don't you address that if you'd like?
The problem is when Section 3 says that these agencies have the current law available to make the goals happen and 180-foot buffers among all surface waters in the designation, which would include ponds, would include lakes, tributaries to it. It implies that that power exists currently, and I'm telling you it does not in any of my experience, and I have a farm background, I have cattle, I have row crop. We have a 40-foot buffer Bermuda grass field on the Black River to help decrease erosion. That was a voluntary program we did. We didn't participate with the government or anybody. So even though it has not happened, the order itself implies and in fact states explicitly they have a panoply of ability to do these things, including withdrawing 30% of agricultural acres that are eligible to be put into conservation programs.
And this is all explicit in the order.
Correct.
Now, the order so far has only been applied to two rivers, one in Connecticut and then the White River that was later withdrawn. So they really haven't had an opportunity yet to apply the explicit provisions of the order that are clear to anyone who cares to read them. Is that correct?
Correct, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for bringing that back.
You know, it reminds me of something that Abraham Lincoln said in his famous House Divided speech. He said we have to look not only at the law, but also the machinery that the law embodies, how it could be used. He says, let anyone who doubts carefully contemplate that now almost complete legal combination, piece of machinery, so to speak, compounded by the Nebraska Doctrine and the Dred Scott decision, let him consider not only what work the machinery is adapted to do and how well adapted, but also let him study the history of its construction and trace if he can, or rather fail if he can, to trace the evidence of design and concert of action among its chief architects from the beginning. As you look at this machinery that's been constructed and the history of its construction and how it is and who will be wielding it and what their policies have been, what do you conclude from this Blue Ways order?
I conclude they intend to comply with what its intent is, which is to reduce the acres, increase 180-foot buffer zones, and within what they believe are current sections of law, able to do that.
And apparently there are some members of Congress who are quite content to allow that machinery to be brought into action with the wanton destruction of an untold number of jobs and with enormous damage to local economies before Congress does anything about it. With the clear view, as has been stated to the subcommittee, that power is exclusively granted to the Congress, not to the Secretary of the Interior.
I believe that, yes.
I will yield back the balance of my time. Mr. Paul.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing a second round. There's a question. I guess the Blue River designation was included the White River, which apparently they've withdrawn. It's been withdrawn. And the fact that the Secretary is pausing the whole program is not necessarily because it's flawed. It's, I believe, that something needs to happen, whether it's because of the questions brought forth by Congress or whether it's impact on whoever is bringing up these issues. There is only one designated National Blue Way, and that's Connecticut River. It encompasses the four states of Connecticut, Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont. And it serves about 4 million people who live along the river, even going through Springfield, the second largest city in Maine. Mr. Sutton, do you believe these citizens do not care about their private property rights? And have there been instances of land taking or water taking in and from the Connecticut River?
I believe they do care about their rights, and I'm not aware of any issues.
You've kind of hit upon some of the benefits that have been very evident with the businesses creating the jobs and creating economy in the area. Why do you think this is so important?
Why Blue Ways is important? Again, I think crafted appropriately and applied appropriately to communities that want it, like our community, we would cherish this kind of designation because it recognizes the efforts that a diverse stakeholder group, inclusive of private business, local government, Native American reservation, public utility, all care about our rivers and waterways, and we want to see that kind of recognition program help brand the region and have some of the benefits that we've talked about in terms of health and wellness, ecological integrity, recreational benefits, etc.
Were you consulted in regard to this designation at all?
No, this has been a completely bottom-up, local, stakeholder-driven initiative.
So you feel that even though you were not involved or your agencies or businesses were not involved, it's still beneficial?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Lomas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Regarding the statutory authority for the National Blue Ways Program, Mrs. Bud Fallon, you've looked at the statutes. Is there, first of all, any one existing statute standing alone that gives the Department of the Interior the authority to designate these blue ways?
No, I have not found a single statute.
And how then have they justified creating this program?
They actually listed three statutes plus, and I quote, a panoply of other authorities, which I'm not exactly sure what that means. And most importantly, they listed the America's Great Outdoors Initiative, which was also not created by statute. It was created by a presidential executive order through college listening sessions across the country. So that did not have full public input either. But they listed the Take Pride in America Act, which is basically a statute that encourages Americans to enjoy the natural resources and participate in recreation, but it doesn't govern anything. They cited the Outdoor Recreation Act, which is specifically discusses national wildlife refuges, national fish hatcheries, and other conservation areas currently administered by the Secretary of Interior for wildlife purposes. So that is not statutory authority to create this huge blue ways that covers state and private land. The third act that they cite is the Cooperative Watershed Management Program of the Omnibus Public Lands Management Act of 2009. Although that talks about creating watershed programs, it's only applicable to very specific bureaus within Department of Interior. And under those specific authorities, it is very specific as to what each bureau can do. It does not apply to the giant Department of Interior to create a new program. And that's what they listed as their statutory authority in the order.
So by cherry-picking or cobbling together these different statutes enacted by Congress in different contexts to create the basis for their legal authority, what kind of legal precedent is being set by the Blue Ways Order?
Actually, I believe this is very dangerous precedent because the federal government, as Congress knows, has very broad authorities that you have set. But you also, in your statutes, told them the priorities for their authority. And if you now allow agency departments and agencies to start picking and choosing what they want to implement and why, and creating new programs out of whole cloth, If it starts with blue ways, it will clearly go into something else. You're simply losing control of the bureaucracy, and you are an equal branch of government. You should be setting the programs and priorities, not some federal agency that we cannot elect and we have no control over.
Thank you. Now, turning to Judge Griffin, in terms of federal officials that were driving, you know, this thing in the White River area, how do you think they were able to convince some of the local governments in the watershed to support the Blue Way?
They were solicited in hopes of gaining additional federal funding for projects that they were working cooperatively currently to achieve.
Okay, so a federal financial carrot was dangled in front of some of the folks that took a bite out of it, right?
That is my understanding from what they told me.
And were other groups that are riparian to this watershed area consulted?
None that I'm aware of.
Now, here's a question for Mr. Bacon. I know you testified that in your case, the process was a locally determined vision for a waterway. After listening to Judge Griffin and Mrs. Bud Fallon, would you call these processes, especially the one for the White River Blue Way, a locally determined vision for a waterway?
Based on the testimony, I think there are opportunities for the Department of Interior to improve its processes.
Do you think, though, that there were groups that should have been included that weren't?
It would seem so.
In your case, how did you all ensure that process would be inclusive of stakeholders that were riparian to the area?
So we, exclusive of the Blue Ways process, we have acknowledged and created a stakeholder group to grow the outdoor
Why exclusive to the process?
I would say not exclusive, but independent of the process.
Independent?
We were doing it anyway. We think
you
it's important.
You were doing it anyway?
Yes.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Mr. Tipton.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I just had a couple of questions. Ms. Bud Fallon, you made the comment in our previous series of questions, when agencies make designations, they take on a life of their own. And I believe you were just speaking to this again. Do you have a deep concern if a Blue Ways program is allowed to be able to proceed? It doesn't stop there. We'll see compounded rules, compounded regulations. And if I understood you correctly, you've got a deep concern that a rule or a regulation which has the impact of law is going to expand far beyond a lot of original intent.
I believe that is exactly the case, and I believe if you simply look back on the pattern of other designations, including designations like wild and scenic and wilderness that are created by Congress, that those take on a life of their own, regardless of the sideboards that are put on it. They just take on a life of their own because of bureaucracies or because of federal court litigation.
Judge, you've dealt with a lot of local issues. Have you seen that to be a tendency out of the federal government? That once a program is initiated, it doesn't stop, it just expands and grows and has impacts on the local community?
It seems to become a living, breathing entity of its own.
Right. Mr. Justice, any comment?
Well, I completely agree with that it does grow, but another thing that I would like to point out is that one of the things that the Blue Way designation said that one of the reasons they were enacting this was because of the positive steps that local people were taking and local groups were taking in conservation. Well, that just shows that we were doing it already because we were motivated to do it for ourselves. We weren't motivated to do it for some higher power of federal government. So we're taking care of it. We don't need this. And I must disagree a little bit with Mr. Bacon when he said that this was a positive thing. We wanted the recognition. We wanted to be recognized for this. We don't. We want to be left alone.
Thank you for that. And Mr. Bacon, I'm just interested a little bit maybe in your business. Do you have to have a permit?
We do.
For your permit?
Yes, sir.
Does the government have the right to be able to rescind the permit?
Under some circumstances.
And Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'd like to maybe broaden this discussion just a little bit from my end. We not only have blueways, but we also have the national forest as a conditional use of permit requiring ski areas in my part of the country and your part of the country. Farmers, ranchers, who have paid for and developed water rights that are coming off of public lands, because in Colorado it all comes off of public lands. If they do not comply, they are going to have to sign over their water rights in order to be able to get that permit. This is a control reach by the federal government, and I see the two series that are working in unison, actually. Conditional use of permit, followed up now by blueways, and you'd brought up, and I believe we're going to be having some hearings and talking with Secretary Jewell, hopefully, in regards to the sage grouse. We are seeing the West being greatly challenged by the expansive and heavy hand of the federal government and the impacts that that is going to have on our communities and the future of our ability to be able to raise our families and for moms to be able to take care of those families, I don't think that we can overstate. So, Mr. Chairman, I applaud you for holding this hearing, and again, I'd like to thank all of the panel for taking the time to come in and testify. I yield back.
Thank you. I believe that concludes the committee's questions. I again want to thank the witnesses for their indulgence of the committee's schedule today, and Mr. Bacon, who I think may have had to postpone a flight. Thank all of you for your service to the committee. Chair would also like to thank our assistant committee clerk, Mr. Riley Weaver, for generously donating his free time to assist our clerk,
Mr. Chair, is he in training?
I think he's already trained, as a matter of fact. At any rate, if there's no further business to come before the committee, and also just a quick warning, you may get additional questions by the committee members. The committee record will be open for 10 days to receive additional comments. And with that, if there's no further business, the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Nice to meet you. Yeah, you too, man. Thank you. He'll remember that, so I appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
Good. Well, that was fun. It's good to meet you, man.
Thank you. Thank you.
We're working toward that.
And thank you for that introduction. I was not expecting that.
Well, I tell you, I'm just so thrilled because your breadth of experience around the West with issues that this could evolve into. And will evolve.
Well, it will evolve. That new MOU just scares me to death.
It is, and it's great that you have those specific examples you can point to and say, this is what will happen, because this is what has happened.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So much.
So, that's what you wanted?
Yes, that's fantastic.
Okay.
Let's talk later.
Okay.
Enjoy dinner.
All right, thank you.
Nice. That was excellent. Of course, that was as we expected.
I knew where he was going.
You
seemed like an attorney.
Yeah, he was clearly an attorney.
Silly argument he was trying to make.
They haven't done it yet.
Yeah.
My favorite are the ones that ask like questions like that, and then as soon as they're done, just get up and leave.
Right.
Yeah.
My work here is
really
done.
Care what the rest is said.
Yeah.
I think it makes them only hear one side of the thing.
Yes,
it is. stretches to the Oregon border. So he had that little yeah, it's a strip that goes all the way up, so he's mostly rural and agricultural, basically, mostly. There are a ton of berries and natural
resources. There's not very many people.
Exactly, so that small city of San Francisco, the Bay Area, elected him. Otherwise, I guarantee
it's amazing that that's a wayward district.
Never dull moments.
Should I sit from this?
Yeah. If you don't mind helping, man.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Hey, Matt. Is there a trash can we're going to throw these away at?
Yeah,
right there. Okay. Hi, Camille. I'm Alex. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.